just one point I wanted to make, which is that this is a session that I think will have interest to a wider audience outside of the Green Gathering who can be here today. So if you've got questions, and I really hope people do ask questions, can you just wait and then speak it into the microphone so that it can be picked up on the monitors and therefore people can listen to it afterwards? That would be really great. So that might slow things down a bit. But anyway, without further ado, I don't know who's going to kick off. Merrick?
Okay, so we're going to, I'm just going to outline what actually has happened with the undercover policing that we know of. Jenny's going to talk about her work, but we want to kind of get through that as quickly as possible and open it up, because I'm sure kind of all the good stuff to say will come up in questions, but I'm sure people will have questions that we don't cover in a longer talk. So what we're talking about is the history of Britain's secret political police force. And now they've been infiltrators from the government for as long as they've been government. But this stuff that we're talking about started in 1968 after there was a demo at the American Embassy against the Vietnam War. And it really kicked off and it embarrassed the government a lot. And they're like, how did we not see this coming? And so they invented a unit called the Special Demonstration Squad. And 10 officers grew their hair, turned into hippies, handed in their warrant cards and went and lived in the protest movement. And they would stay in there for years at a time, being very, very involved. Forming very close relationships with people. And this was done to gather intelligence. This is not about gathering evidence for court cases and securing convictions. This is just to know who's doing what in active politics. And there have been a couple of subsequent units, but we're talking probably around 200 officers who've done this work since 1968. And they're there to counter threats, and they don't distinguish between the threat of political violence, a threat to corporate profit, a threat to the credibility of the police force, people who might embarrass the police for showing them up for doing what they actually have done, and a threat to the established political order. They see all these things as equivalent. A threat to life and limb is the same as an anti-capitalist idea catching on. So if you're active in politics outside of the sort of sliver of the spectrum that's represented in the House of Commons, you're of interest. They want to undermine you. And if you've been doing that work, you probably have been fooled by an undercover police officer. And it's essentially a counter-democratic remit. It's there to stop change. And as the one whistleblower officer out of that unit has said, you know, if we'd had the Special Demonstration Squad at the turn of the 20th century, the suffragettes would never have got going. So it's a very, very secret unit. Special Branch is a division within each police force that is secret anyway, and we don't quite know what a lot of what they do. The Special Demonstration Squad was within the Metropolitan Police, and most Metropolitan Police officers didn't know it even existed. A lot of senior officers won't have known it even existed. It was so secret. And so because they had no accountability, they kind of acted without rules as well. And power tends to abuse of power, which is why you need accountability for it. Unaccountable power tends towards abuse. And the abuses that happened since they kicked in 68, probably the most shocking is the close personal relationships they formed. Of the 14 officers that we know some details of, 13 of them had sexual relationships with activists that they lived among. And most of these had long-term, committed, life partner, kind of quasi-marital relationships. Three out of these 14 had children with women that they targeted. And, you know, one of the worst of them, Bob Lambert, had a planned child that he knew he would abandon and walk off and leave, and that kid would be left looking for his dad for the rest of his life. And this is abuse. This is psychological abuse, and this is institutional sexism. They also went for family justice campaigns. We had the admission last week, the royal document showing they infiltrated, well, they spied on 18 family justice campaigns. We're talking people like Stephen Lawrence's family, and we know that that's just the tip of it. You know, there's no mention of other special branches spying on, say, the Hillsborough families, which is something that did happen. The admissions that we got last week are nothing. They're just going on what the documents show, because most of the documents, well, lots of stuff was never written down, and what documents did get made have largely been shredded. In fact, the ones that proved that they spied on those 18 families should have been shredded, but this unit was such a law unto itself that it didn't follow shredding protocol. But this again, this is attacking people who have done nothing that anybody could call wrong. These are people who just want the truth of what has actually happened. But it undermines police credibility. It shows the police up to be failing, to be racist, and that is a threat to them. And so they treat that as if you were a threat of serious public disorder. They also stole the identities of dead children. In up to the early 90s, they would go and find a child who died with the same first name as the officer, and they would take on that identity. So they had a birth certificate, so they had some documentation, so they could make themselves appear as if they were a real person. And which is, it's obviously in poor taste to resurrect, but there's, you know, it's, and it is, I was out celebrating Rod Richardson's birthday with him a few years ago, except it wasn't his birthday, because the 5th of January is the birthday of the real Rod Richardson, who died aged 2 days. So on the night, you know, when the real Rod Richardson's family are having their most somber day of the year, there he was drinking tequila and doing Firestarter on the karaoke. But the real issue with the dead children is it actually puts the families in threat. There's one of them called John Dines, who stole the identity of a kid called John Barker. And John Barker, the real John Barker's brother Anthony, says, well, what if these officers are infiltrating people who are violent? What if they're infiltrating people who do serious drugs trading, guns trading, and those people have got suspicious and think they found the mole, and they get that dead child's birth certificate and they come to our house? You know, you're putting bereaved families in danger for no other reason than they're bereaved. Again, it's this cavalier attitude towards the lives and the welfare of citizens. We know that the undercover officers also supplied information for illegal blacklisting. There was the one that's been discovered, the construction industry blacklist, where several thousand people were on a list used by most of the major construction firms. And if you had raised health and safety concerns, if you were a union activist, if you were a bit left-wing, then the firms reported you, it was kept, and then when the next firm comes to employ you, you get vetted. If you're on the list, you don't get in. Thousands of people denied a livelihood for not wanting to work with asbestos or whatever. And it's a completely illegal list, and yet it was the job of Special Branch all around the country to supply it with information. Again, the whistleblower officer has said his information he believes was on use for the blacklist. So again, it's that thing about not upholding the law. In fact, that's breaking the law to uphold corporate profit, because you're a threat to corporate profit. The law just doesn't matter. And the final kind of large element of this is the miscarriages of justice that we've seen with Mark Kennedy. There've been a number of convictions overturned because he was in the middle of of an action which came to court. People got convicted, and the evidence he had that exonerated people didn't come to court because people didn't know that he was in fact a cop in their midst. And we've had 49 convictions overturned, another six people's trial collapsed. That would have been 55 wrongful convictions from Kennedy alone that we know of. If you take him as an average and multiply it by the number of officers, we're looking at about 8,000 wrongful convictions being left to stand. If he's anomalous, if you just say one wrongful conviction per officer per year of service, which is incredibly conservative, we're looking at about 600 wrongful convictions being left to stand. And they know who it is because they know who the officers were and what cases they're involved in, and we're not being told about this. This is one of the biggest nobblings of the judicial system in history, and almost no one's talking about this aspect. They went for court case in other ways as well, because officers would sometimes be arrested and sometimes go to court and even be convicted under their false identity. But this means there are officers in defendants' meetings. As the defendants are meeting their lawyers, one of the defendants is a copper reporting back. This is a complete breach of lawyer-client privilege, and again, totally undermining the judicial system, because no respect for law, just for the work of the unit, just to scupper these activists. So there've been a number of inquiries since Kennedy was first uncovered 3-4 years ago now, and they tend to parcel off a little bit of the issue and then give the smallest answer they can. And lots of these things, like the Rose report into police collusion with the Crown Prosecution Service over one of the collapsed trials, is now completely discredited. Loads of these reports are discredited as more information comes out, because they're police self-investigations, or they're investigations by satellite bodies like the Independent Police Complaints Commission, which is largely staffed by ex-coppers and always takes the copper's side if there's any doubt. or satellite bodies like Her Majesty's Inspector of Constabulary, again, which is senior police officers looking into it. It's them marking their own homework. And there's a massive one at the moment, Operation Hearn, which again, this is 3/4 of the staff are Metropolitan Police staff, including serving officers. This is not credible. And so it's a waste of time. It's a decoy. It's a sham. There is a promised proper public inquiry under the Inquiries Act, Leveson style, which they haven't set the terms of reference for that. So again, we don't know how much of a whitewash that's going to be. So the time is now to put the pressure on to make the terms of reference, make this be a clear, comprehensive, credible inquiry. But yeah, the work is still to do on that. With that, I'm going to hand over to Jenny.
Thank you. Merrick talked about people who are going to, that the SDS targeted people who are going to overthrow the established political order. Now, without being immodest, I like to think that I'm part of the established political order because I've been elected 5 times now and I sit in the House of Lords, and yet I found out last year that I am on the Met's file of domestic extremists. I was very flattered. I've put it up as a notice on my door now, so it doesn't say Jenny Jones, it says domestic extremist. It also says green blogger, of course, because I expect some of you have seen Owen Paterson's comments about the green blob. A lot has happened. Merrick and I have done this double act. He called it Morecambe and Wise, and I'm not sure who the short fat one is, but I think it could be me. you're the one with the glasses, yeah. A lot has changed since last year, in fact. And when we were talking earlier, we were saying it's a little bit like sometimes you have to go for the thing that isn't really the thing you're going for, but it's close to it, and then gradually you sort of erode the brick wall in front of you that is stopping you getting any information. I've been following the sort of political path, as it were, on this. I spent a long time trying to get the Met and ACPO, that's the Association of Chief Police Officers, and the Home Office, to change how they define domestic extremism. So that instead of spying on activists, they actually spy on serious criminals. And the Met finally changed their definition at the end of last year, and they announced it in March. And the definition now focuses, it says, domestic extremism relates to the activity or groups of individuals who commit or plan serious criminal activity motivated by a political or ideological viewpoint. I think it could still be open to abuse, that description, but at least it does talk about serious criminality, which is a good move. I'm also part of a legal action, along with Caroline Lucas, the Green MP, against the National Domestic Extremism and Disorder Intelligence Units database. This is one of the problems, actually. I can never keep, I'm hopeless on acronyms. I can't keep up with all these changes of names, but it's the NDEDIU, for anybody who's making notes. And that's the database on which I have a file. Very, very flattering. The file was interesting. When I did a subject access request. Anybody can do this. You can spend £10 and get your file if you've got one. And mine, when I got it, I actually asked for my £10 back because it was so pathetic. It was bits of gossip. It was the fact that I'd spoken in Trafalgar Square. It was the fact I'd gone to a Stop the War demonstration to bring our troops home and things like that. I mean, it was rubbish. Of course, they might have redacted it. I've got no idea. And I was also offended that they hadn't even got the time when I drove a van full of activists up to Ratcliffe on Sour to blockade the power station. They hadn't got that. And I did complain to the commissioner about it, but I still haven't got my £10 back. As part of this legal action, I've given we're trying to establish whether or not Caroline Lucas and I have been kept under surveillance, if our emails and our phones have been tapped. And it's part of a court case that's going through, that the solicitors are using us as a test case. It's all pro bono, very good of them. We went to court recently, and it was absolutely painful, but it is creeping forward at a snail's pace. There's also, I gave a witness statement in support of a legal case of John Catt. I don't know how many people know him. He's an 89-year-old pensioner from Brighton who campaigns for peace and human rights. And he had a file on the same database, which even included descriptions of his appearance, which is clean-shaven, and his habit of sketching at demos. And The police are actually due to appeal this case at the Supreme Court later this year. This is one of the things that offends me deeply. It's the fact that they are actually, they're doing all this with public money, the Met. They actually spend thousands. The Spy Cops case against the women who brought the legal case has cost so far nearly £150,000, all public money, to defend the Met's reputation, which is already in tatters. There's also the fact that there used to be a police authority, which was a very useful way of trying to hold the Met to account, because there were 23 of us, and we all different political parties. We had even UKIP on there at one point. And I say that with a sneer in my voice, but actually he was very good on civil liberties. So we did sometimes agree. And we were able to at least to keep these issues bubbling along. The Mayor of London is now the police and crime commissioner for the Met, for the whole of London. And I'm afraid he does not keep any sort of close eye on the Met, which means who's watching them, basically. We do our best at the London Assembly. And apparently Boris has set up a covert forum to discuss undercover policing with the Met, where the forum will hear about statistics and that sort of thing. It's not the sort of intrusive oversight I'd really like to have seen. It does worry me now that we've been through, obviously, decades of bits of the police being out of control, and there have been various people trying to keep an eye on them, but now it's worse than ever it has been before. I've also been lobbying to try to get the terms of deployment for undercover officers to include an explicit commitment that officers are never to have sexual relationships with the people they are targeting. In countries like Germany, this is already illegal. And I've been lobbying on this. And the commissioner keeps saying, of course it's not allowed. You know, nobody would ever say it's allowed. But that runs counter to the information that we've had from Peter Francis, who said that it did happen. It's slow going on the political front. I'm also working with a member of the German Bundestag about the deployment of British undercover police in Germany, where they committed crimes and had sexual relationships with people who didn't know that they were undercover police officers. And also there's the neither confirm nor deny policy. Now this drives us mad, wouldn't you say? And NCND, is that terrible with acronyms? And that's actually being challenged in the courts at the moment. So I really hope, I mean, this public inquiry that's been announced by Theresa May, I really hope that goes ahead, that it's judge-led, and that it is something that does go into the details of this, so that we can, and that has some sort of commitment to publishing a report that isn't a whitewash. It has been, it's a long, hard fight, and as I say, we are chipping away at various bits of it, and it's been, one of the things that's been good about it, I think, is that a lot of the women who are bringing the appeal and their lawyers and activists like Merrick and politicians like me have been able to work together. And it's actually lovely to sit down. We had a meeting at the House of Lords. I booked a room at the House of Lords, and it was great taking all these people in. It felt really subversive to have them all in there. And so I do hope that we are making progress.
Okay, we're taking questions. Just to be aware, this is being videoed. It's going out live streaming, and it will be YouTubed after. So watch the range of the camera if you don't want to be on that. But also make sure that either you speak the question into the mic or get us to repeat it into the mic so that for the benefit of the people watching on video will know what we're talking about.
Merrick, I think we've got a mic on a cable. If you use that, we'll pass the other one around.
Okay, so any questions? Yeah.
Thanks a lot for coming, and I'm sorry that I missed some of your talk. It's a basic point, really, that if you're doing what the Tory party are doing or the coalition are doing in Britain, you need a police force that isn't very good and that is terrifying activists. And this has been going on quite a long time. I mean, I can remember going to things 6 years ago where people who were approaching activism were really frightened off, climate camps, those kind of things, by police tactics. And do you see this as deliberate? Do you see that there is a hand-in-glove thing going on where the Tory party are deliberately allowing the police to behave in this way, because they're, as you pointed out, pretty incompetent on occasions, and that's part of what makes it frightening, I think.
Weirdly, actually, the Met is, in particular, well, most police forces are actually furious at the Tory government at the moment because of the various things that the police are doing. I mean, massive, massive cuts to their funding and things like that. But, of course, their aims are more or less the same, which is to keep things as they are. And what I'm assuming that most of us here would like things to be different. We want things to be better. And so, unfortunately, we run counter to the government. I don't think it's a close cooperation, except at perhaps very senior level. You know, witness the attempts by the Downing Street police to make trouble for a senior Tory politician. I think there's a lot of anger, but at senior level, of course, their aims are absolutely the same, to keep things as they are.
You sing a lot of Tories. This isn't just a Tory thing. You know, the climate camps you're talking about went on under Labour. It's like I say, if you're active in politics outside of what's represented in the House of Commons, they want to stop you, they want it undermined. And yeah, this is a deliberate tactic. They knew at something like that they were over-policing when they're doing all the King's North, all those huge stop and searches of everybody going in and out, the illegal stop and searches they were doing. The spin in the press about finding a cache of weapons that was a piece of chain with a padlock on it. And then saying, 70 officers have been injured. And then we did the FOI request and found out not one of those was from interaction with activists. It was, sunburn, it was falling out of the car, it was stung by a probable wasp. All this stuff is there, absolutely, to intimidate people from coming in, to make you think, I'm not sure if I want to come back next time, I'm not sure. It's the same objective, absolutely, because they knew it was over-policing. We know they know it's over-policing because at King's North, you know, deep in the organisation of King's North, organising all the transport, Mark Stone. You know, in all the meetings, they know what it is and who it is. So the over-policing has to be a deliberate strategy. They don't sort of waste money for the fun of it.
This may be following on from that question, really. It's like, be interested in your opinion on what you think the purpose of this undercover policing is. I mean, obviously, going back to 68, you get this kind of general paranoia about this new wave of activist demonstrations and so on against the Vietnam War in particular. But now it seems to me to be almost more about destabilizing, frightening, undermining, you know, demoralizing, rather than information gathering. I mean, you look at someone like Mark Stone, Kennedy, whatever, you know, he comes across as a rather pathetic figure afterwards. He doesn't come across as very smart. I don't know if you'd agree with that. I can't believe that he's actually delivering really, really secret information that the police can't, you know, I mean, it's quite easy to find out what's going on in the activist world in many ways. You know, no one does security vetting, no one does, you know. I'm interested what you think it's for now.
Well, it's as you said at the start, I mean, but it's 90% of what we do is very public and easy to find out. But there's that stuff that they want to stop that they're not going to find out unless they're deeply involved. When people have got a secret plan to go and, you know, occupy and shut down a power station for a week, you know, then they want something, and you only get to be in the middle of that by having done a lot of that open stuff for years on end. And so that's what people like Kennedy were in there to do. And you know, he's a, you know, really lovely guy to be around. I'm sure he was handing back exactly the information they wanted. That's why they left him in for so very long. They wouldn't have done that, again, to just waste the money for the fun of it. But they're doing it, as I say, to undermine political change. It's a counter-democratic remit, and they want any threats to... So if you're... It's not about violence on the streets. You know, when the big three units that were doing this work were all being overseen by the coordinator for domestic extremism, who was a guy called Adrian Tudway, in 2011. And there was a leaked email from him saying that the EDL aren't domestic extremists. Racist violence on the streets is fine. But if your climate camp, who they tried to get a riot out of so many times and they got their hands in the air, this is not a riot, defiance, that one they come down on. It's because it was serious. It was an anti-capitalist idea that was catching on, so that wanted squashing. So actually, it doesn't matter if you're violent or not or any of that stuff. It's there. It's there about stuff that's outside the status quo catching on. That's what it's there to stop.
There are, of course, undercover police that do the sort of jobs that I personally would like them to do. For example, there are undercover cops who go into people trafficking rings and you know, massive, arms sort of, supply through. you know, sometimes undercover policing, I would argue, do actually do stuff for us. And there are also people who would like to commit terrorist atrocities here and, you know, witness the bombs in London. So, the police do argue that there is a genuine need for undercover police. Where we would differ from them, where all of us would differ from them, is saying that, well, you don't need it for environmentalists, because generally we're a fairly fluffy lot. I mean, I've got quite a temper, but I'm not violent. And when the SDS put out a statement of purpose, this is the Hearn report, by the way, for anybody, I gather Merrick prints it, if anybody wants to get it. It's not very long, quite easy to read, full of absolute crap. But the SDS, in their statement of purpose, said, providing quality service in the gathering and dissemination of high-grade intelligence concerning terrorism, public order events, the activities of groups involved in politically motivated crime and crime related to animal rights and environmental activity. This is the problem. They're mixing up so many things. And they say to achieve this, the infiltrated groups assessed as being capable of violent protest. Now, we all know that's complete nonsense, and it does seem that they just got confused and were desperate to get any intelligence. Most of the stuff that was got from environmental groups appears to have been just rubbish. I mean, a bit like my file on the database, you know, just gossip, and a few names crop up here and there, but complete rubbish. So what their aim is, I mean, you can argue it's counter-terrorism, you can argue it's counter, you know, trafficking or whatever, but when it comes to groups like Climate Camp, you have to say, you know, it's not a genuine purpose.
I just wanted to pick up, Jenny, on what you were saying about, like, oh, there are some undercover operations that are okay. I think, personally, that we need to be massively careful about going down that route, about kind of going, oh, it's just because we were fluffy and they should, you know, not infiltrate us. They should just go after the bad guys. And I think, like, this point was made really clearly for me when I read the testimony that some of the women whose lives were abused, they gave to Parliament. And some of the points in that they made to Parliament, I thought were really, really, really important. And one of the things that was said, that they said, was that this should happen to no one. This kind of abusing a life should happen to no one. And they said, you know, and that what's happening in those situations, particularly with the relationships issue, is that, I think this is a line from their testimony, is that it's the police acting like, not just police, but the judge and jury. So they're deciding who is a criminal, inflicting this life abuse on them, and they get to decide. That's giving somebody a life sentence. That's the police deciding to do that through their operation, is inflicting this sort of abuse on them of messing around with somebody's life. And I think that's a really challenging point for us, and we really have to take it on board. We have to challenge the idea that the police are there just to protect us, and occasionally they go a bit wayward. And we have to actually look at what they do when they've got power, and we have to limit that. We have to say, that's not going to be okay. These are members of the public that their lives are abusing, and even if the members of the public were about to commit a crime, even at that point, we have a judge and jury system to decide what they should do if they have committed a crime. The evidence has to be weighed. This isn't what they're doing. They're inflicting that. So I think we should be careful. I'm not saying, oh no, terrorists should get away with it, but I'm just saying it's not the police's role to abuse a terrorist's life and for the rest of us to say, stand back and say, oh, that's fine.
I agree completely with you, but there's a very big difference between the sort of undercover policing that goes on for trafficking rings or counter-terrorism and what happened with environmental groups. It's very, very different. With the trafficking and so on, they go in, it's a short-term sort of thing, they do not have the same relationships, they are they go in and they come out, they go in, they come out. It's not the same. With the environmental groups, they embedded themselves, and this is where that they have abused so many people. But for other areas of undercover policing, it is done very, very differently. And the police officers who were involved in the embedding themselves in the environmental groups often came out of it very, very confused human beings, because they actually got to like everybody. And that's not true. But some of them began to understand what the environmental cause was about. And so they came out, you know, not are you making a noise? You know, so it is a very different sort of undercover policing. The counterterrorism is quite different, and that's mostly on mostly on interceptions and things like that.
It is badged as counterterrorism now. Those units have now been subsumed and amalgamated. It's now Counterterrorism Command that deploys today's Mark Kennedys and Bob Lamberts. But coming back to what you were saying, firstly, the sexual relationships, they are never justified in any circumstances for anybody ever at all. It is illegal in Germany. What's Germany suffering that we need protecting from? You know, it's never, ever justified for anyone. They're saying they should do it for serious people, and this ties in with their new definition of domestic extremists, which is just people who do serious criminal activity. They define us as doing serious criminal activity. Who defines what serious means? They define the Ratcliffe Power Station as seriously criminal. So, you know, they will still target everybody. And we know that they target, without accountability, they abuse. This is what the big lesson has been of what we discover this. Every single one of them has abused their position and abused the citizens that they were spying on. And so we know that power tends towards abuse. We know that really with this unaccountability, they do that. So to say that they can then go in and do it to other people's lives, this puts an enormous amount of trust in people who have proven themselves unworthy of that trust ever to be had. And also we're assuming that they will get it right. And again, what we know from this is they cast a very wide net. They spy on all kinds of people. They infiltrate and abuse people who weren't really anything to do with activism. And so their idea of domestic extremists is why, in the same way, their definition of people trafficker or somebody who might be up to some terrorism will be very, very wide. And so, you know, they cannot be trusted in this. And they can't prove themselves worthy of the trust to do that kind of infiltration.
Yeah, hi. I just wanted to come back on the point about terrorism. I'm very clear. I'm actually one of the women who was deceived into a relationship with an undercover police officer. So that's the starting point. But just to say that the clear purpose of these units is to undermine dissent. And when they try and muddy the waters by claiming that it's to prevent terrorism, I think you need to look at a few statistics. Like, it was reported just a couple of months ago that something like 28,000 people die prematurely from pollution, that 1,000 people die a year from asthma as a result of inadequate facilities, which they've got in other countries, so we've got an excess death rate compared to them. In the UK, since 2001, there have been just 59 terrorism-related deaths. So if this was about... If all this was about saving people's lives, why isn't all the funding that's wasted on spying on campaign groups redirected into preventing pollution and preventing, providing good care for people with asthma and other health conditions? Coming back on some of the other things that have been said, I just wanted to say, I think it's very important that everyone is aware of the efforts by the state and powerful institutions to undermine movements for social progress, and to be clear that that's what this is about. And so basically so that we can all learn how to resist what they're doing. But I also think it's very important that we don't let our own fear and suspicion undermine our own efforts to create social change, because that's another thing that actually is very beneficial for them if we're all worried about doing anything, because we're worried about whether this person is real or not. And a kind of final note is we should also take heart from the fact that they do infiltrate our campaigns, because it shows that actually we do have an effect. And that if we keep on at it, we can bring about change if we carry on communicating with people, spreading alternative ideas and encouraging people that we don't have to live in this crazy, selfish society that we've currently got.
Yeah, if I can just expand on some of that. I think we need to look at the stuff that our movements have done since 1968 and the things that we've achieved with these fuckers in the middle of us. We've still pulled off some awesome things. And now we still have you know, those desires, and we still have that momentum, but we know a lot of what to watch for. And so, you know, if they got a bit of money and they got the van and they work away and you never met their mum, maybe that's not someone you invite on the secret stuff. You know, and so we're actually in a stronger position than we ever been in. And just think of all the stuff that inspired us that first got us involved. You know, when I think they pulled off Greenham Common with coppers in the middle of it. Brilliant. You know, so imagine what we can do next. Get the mic.
It'd be good to develop that to give us a way of reassuring people who are entering political activism about how nervous or not they should be. And then if you could just go through, for the benefit of the webinar, just those, some of those points and where people can access that list, I think that would be really brilliant. Thank you. I think it'd be really good if you could say a little bit about why we shouldn't be really afraid. You know, how competent are they? Should we be worried? Should people entering activism be very worried or not? And I understand there's a list online that you can look at of how to assess whether somebody might be a bit sus or not, and whether that's a good idea to look at that list.
We were asked at Glastonbury this, because it was somebody who'd got a group and they were worried that they'd got an infiltrator in it. And you can't live with that sort of paranoia. You have to somehow, you know, just battle through. Just as Helen's just said, you know, if that stops us doing what we're trying to do, then they've succeeded. I don't know anything about the list, and it seems like a really good idea. I'll look it up.
Yeah, firstly, like as I said, most of what we do is, it's fine. Know about, you know, it's stuff you want to publicly organize, and if you don't do any outreach, you're going to have a movement of just yourself in a room. And so, you know, this happened in America in the 20s when the trade union movement got very strong. It was heavily infiltrated by corporate spies, and like Pinkerton's agency boasted that a third of their spies actually held office in the unions they were spying on. But what actually really ruined the movement in the 30s was people had sussed there were spies and they were too scared to work with anybody. And so you have to have that trust and say 95% of the time, it's fine. If you're doing something that they are really going to want to stop, that, you know, then, okay, ignore the feelings in your heart and look objectively at the people you want to invite. I don't know of an online list. There really should be one. We need to kind of sort of, but there are certain indicators definitely that a lot of the cops have in common. And, you know, again, they tend to have a lot of money. They tend to have very strong but very vague politics. They'll be, you know, fuck the police and but actually can't, you don't get a sense of that morality inside them, where it comes from. Mostly men. So they'll have a practical skill, which is really useful. It usually takes a bit of money, often being the person with the van. That way they can talk to you a lot about vans or marquees and that kind of stuff. You feel that you've talked about the action or the camp a lot, and yet you haven't actually talked politics. My first question for anyone who thinks that someone might be an infiltrator is, do you like them? And people go, no, they're dead annoying. It's like, well, that's not a copper. Because all of them, even the ones who were sent in to be disruptive, were universally liked. You know, they were really nice because they know how to make you trust them. You know, and so you should have a bit of a sob story back in their life so you really feel they've opened up to you. But these things are just indicators. You know, obviously, all of us have some of these things in our lives. You know, all of us have a job where we work away, or there's, you know, a lot of people have good reason why they don't keep in touch with their family and no one meets their family. And so it's not a bingo card. You know, it's indicators. It's like child protection. It's like, it's a couple of things on the child protection list where you tick those boxes. Just means you need looking into. Doesn't mean you are abusing your child. And if you find more, you need looking into a bit more.
Just bringing it home about undercover police and infiltration. As a lot of you will know, in 2009, the Big Green Gathering was infiltrated by the police. Mark Kennedy, alias Mark Stone, alias Flashman, as he was known at the time by the crew, was the DJ in the Last Chance Saloon, which was raising funds for Climate Camp. The festival got stopped 3 days before it was due to open on some trumped up road traffic signs, which were put in place because we had pictures of them at the time. When the festival had been closed down, at the time we was in there to live stream and record the bands and everything, so we was actually in there with cameras. So we carried on rolling and filming people who had trucks with burgers in or whatever, and you know, they couldn't sell it because the festival had been closed down, so they couldn't move to the next festival. There were shops around the Mendips which were full of cider and cheese and all kinds of things. They couldn't sell it because the festival had been closed down. A little later, Brig, Ubridge, asked me a question. He said, Malcolm, could you look through all the footage that you guys have filmed and see if you can see this man, a picture of Mark Kennedy? So we went through all the footage, and that's where we found him, as being the DJ in the Last Chance Saloon. So from that, we took it to the newspapers, and we took it to a chap called Brian Hill, who was doing a documentary on Channel 4 about Mark Kennedy. He was so excited. He said, I never realised he was at the Big Green Gathering. I've been doing a documentary with Mark Kennedy now for 2 years, and he's never mentioned once that he was at the Green Gathering. And he was very excited, saying, oh, we'll buy the rights. He was talking to the directors of the Big Green Gathering, Brian Hill, Channel 4 documentary. So we all waited for the documentary to come out. It came out and there wasn't even a mention. Brian Hill never really got back in touch with me. I managed to get back in touch with Brian Hill, and I said, Brian, because I'd been to London to show him the photographs, to show him some video footage of Kennedy there undercover. He said, Malcolm, what it was, Channel 4 solicitors came down on it really heavy and said it was too hot a potato. They get the newspapers, all the newspapers, just all dropped it. At first they were fighting for, you know, to buy the rights and this, that and the other, which that cash could have gone back into the Green Movement. If there was no cash, we weren't bothered. We just wanted it putting out there. Now, there was also a court case which the Green Gathering had took up to try and, you know, why was this illegal closure? We knew there was undercover policemen there with photographic evidence of these undercover policemen, Mark Kennedy and others. Yeah, but it all got dropped. And Mark Kennedy now is a big security man or something in America. He's a TV star. He's all this sort of stuff. But the people who suffered at the Big Green Gathering that year, and people who suffered through Mark Kennedy and other police officers, they're not really, what justice is there? These people, it just gets dropped, never gets took any further. No one will mention even the closure of the Big Green Gathering in 2009, even though there's photographic evidence. So I would say, worry a bit, check your sources and who knows who, and because they do come in, infiltrate the papers, they put a blanket up on it, so it never ever gets in the media. There's activists out there who've been made pregnant off these people, raped in my eyes, because they have false driving licenses, false passports, false everything, and it, to me, it's very, very wrong.
I've been thinking a lot about what we're doing and why we're so threatening. And what I've come up with is that we're living in a psychopathic system. And if you look up the all the seven signs of a psychopath, it just rings so fantastically true. And what we're trying to do is make it an empathetic system. And that is probably the most frightening thing that a psychopath can come across. So all these people who are working for the psychopaths themselves become compulsive liars, have a hidden agenda, and one of the tools that they use to infiltrate is NLP. I know people that actually teach NLP to police officers. Anyway, never mind. And this is an incredibly powerful tool, and what happens is you feel like you've known someone for 10 years, it's almost hypnotizing, developed by, in America, sales technique. So the first thing I think when you're on any movement at all is to think, now hang on, this person could be doing NLP on me because I don't know them, and yet I feel incredibly comfortable and I want to tell them more and I want to tell them about myself. So, like on an energy level, it sort of bypasses your normal sort of defense mechanisms. So I think as long as you're aware of the sort of techniques that you might be coming across and just have an awareness of that, and that people do lie. I'm a Quaker And when I was young, I didn't think anyone lied, because I was taught not to lie. Oh my God, what a terrible, some terrible things happened because of that. So I think just having that sort of just awareness and checking everything out. And if you haven't known someone for at least 2 years properly, then always keep that defense, that little bit of awareness going. That's all I've got to say. We're trying to create an empathetic world, and that is more threatening than violence. It's more threatening because we're trying to change the world.
Said that there were some women police officers that infiltrated. Do we have to? How many were women?
We've said there've been somewhere 150 to 200 officers who've done this work.
Yeah.
Presumably. We only have partial details on 14, 13 of them were men.
And also, you said about EDL. Is there any evidence of them infiltrating any other sort of like extreme right-wing groups?
They did infiltrate. Yeah, they certainly SDS went for far left, anti-war, environmental, animal rights, and far right.
In the Hearn report, there's a very useful little chart, actually, which shows that they infiltrated extreme left and extreme right. Yeah, here it is. It's a very, very helpful little chart there. And so under Special Branch, C Squad had a desk for animal rights and environmental extremism, and it also had a desk for extreme left wing and extreme right wing. So, you know, they were on the case there, at least. The Hearn report is worth reading, actually, I would say, just to understand what a whitewash looks like.
Yeah, hi, I think the point that I'd like to make is what they're essentially after is control. And so they want to understand, it goes with the riots and things like that. They came down really hard on all the kids who like took packets of Quavers out of Poundland and gave them like 3-month sentences to try and reinstate some sort of control over society. And I think, I guess that's kind of what they're taking to an extreme as well by infiltrating groups and things like that, is kind of to understand, they don't understand what's going on. And they want to have control and understand what's going on. So obviously they're exploiting that access into those places. But essentially that's what they're fighting for. And that's where it goes for everything, isn't it? Across all of society, as a system and an establishment, it's understanding what's going on. And they want to know what it is and how to control it. I think, like you say, they're infiltrating all sorts of left and right systems, which obviously some of them have got very unhealthy ambitions, but other ones have got sort of obviously, you know, prosperous and ambitious goals that they want to achieve, and they're just trying to get control over those parties, I guess. That's sort of the point I'm looking at, really, is where obviously they've exploited their positions in many ways, like you mentioned, but it just comes down to control for them, really, as an establishment. Well, how they go about that is very wrong in many approaches. That's my point, really.
Somebody did mention earlier about they're frightening people off. And, of course, in London, what we've got at the moment is the Mayor of London has just bought 3 water cannon. Now, they're not actually licensed for use on the British mainland at the moment, so they're actually illegal if they use them. But they started training on them, and the whole idea was they had to have them by this summer, because although they didn't have any intelligence about any sort of riots or violence on the streets, they thought it might happen. So now we have water cannon as well. And, you know, a lot of us have argued very, very strongly that they aren't even suitable for London, because they've been used in Northern Ireland. And we've heard from Hugh Ward, who is the Commissioner of Police over there, that they can be used when you've got 2 groups or 2 opposing sides that are fighting over a bit of territory, which is what happens in Northern Ireland. But in the sort of circumstances that happened in the riots in London, they would be absolutely useless. And yet the Met says they've got to have them. When we've challenged the mayor on them, he says, well, the police are the experts. They tell us the tools we need. And I've been saying, Well, they could tell you what they think they need, but you're the politician and you actually should decide for the well-being of the rest of us. But he's lost sight of it. So we have 3 illegal water cannon at the moment that may or may not be licensed.
Lost sight of it implies he ever had sight of it and he's not the same establishment figure that the Mets are themselves.
The way that they dealt with a lot of the May Day protests and the kettling and the knocking over of that, you know, newspaper seller, I forget his name now, but he was just shoved to the ground.
Ian Tomlinson.
Yeah, exactly. And he was just shoved. What they do is they rally up a lot of thugs. And so they, you know, they just want to take their labels off the lapels off their jackets. And then essentially they're sort of thugs for hire, really, where they're sort of like, you know, we're not in control here, so let's bring in some heavies and just try and get some control under these people. And it is through fear, where they're trying to control them through fear and of a physical nature, which is bang out of order, really, because that protest was essentially about equality and fairness, and they'd just go around beating up people, you know. I mean, there was an element of kicking off, but, you know, it happens everywhere you go. There's sort of, is, you know, you get good doctors, you get bad doctors, you get good police, you get bad police.
And by the same
token, you get good bus drivers, you get bad bus drivers. It goes everywhere. Yeah, quite a lot of bad ones, though. So essentially they bring out the thugs and they get heavy. And they lose sight of their drive to protect people. And it was just like there was that one where that woman was swiped around the legs with a truncheon. And this was a big guy without his lapels. And he just loved having the uniform and the power and the truncheon. And throwing it about a bit, basically. So you get an element of that, I think, in the police, where you have, they love the power and they love throwing it around.
Yeah, but it's the same police that you get on other days. It's just they've been told today that this is politically unacceptable, so you go in hard. And sometimes it's the same day. It's the same one who's giving you the, my daughter's a vegetarian speech. Half an hour later, the visor goes down, they're battening the nearest head they can. It's the same officers. They all do it. You know, you look at the lines on that day at the G20, and there's lines and lines, and they're coming in and battening people with their hands in the air, chanting, this is not a riot. And, you know, if there are good police officers in there, why aren't they turning and walking away? Why aren't they dobbing in their mates who are doing that? Not one complaint.
Hi, thanks for coming here and doing the work you're doing. I think it's really good. I've become a bit concerned when I hear you quoting reports as if we can believe them, as if that's just because they write something, it's proof in itself. And I'd like us to become a little bit more analytical about that, perhaps a bit more critical, and say, well, if you claim something in a report, we want to see some evidence or some kind of proof of this, because you could be making up anything for any security concern reason that you dream up yourselves. Also, I'd like to hear some ideas perhaps from you about how we can live in a society beyond the need for a police state, beyond the need for policing itself. What can we do to create that?
I think I've made it clear that I'm not supporting this report. It is very worrying, I would say. But at the same time, the little chart, I think, probably is fairly accurate. It's probably how they did organise themselves. You see, I would like to live in a society where there's no police needed. And I was told that makes me an anarchist. Does it make me an anarchist? I know communities where you don't need policing because everybody more or less understands how to run the society, how to be part of the society they want to exist. But it's always in tiny little groups, and it's quite often in green groups in particular. I'm thinking about Green in a Way, for example, which is a group of people who get together every summer. They put on an outdoor conference centre, and it's just incredibly harmonious. And even the people who come to these conferences, they're not particularly green, many of them, they don't leave litter, they don't make a mess, and it's you can see it in operation. But I have absolutely no idea how you get there with a wider population. Absolutely no idea. I mean, it's almost like asking how to sort out the Palestinian-Israeli problem. It's probably even bigger than that.
I think it's a huge, huge thing that warrants, you know, probably a whole gathering itself, let alone a workshop itself, so I'm not going to spend a long time on it. But, you know, we can start by removing the obstacles. You know, it's like the idea of needing water cannon of any kind on London streets is ridiculous, and maybe riots wouldn't kick off if they didn't spend, the police weren't spending all their time doing stop and searches on black people in London. Maybe you wouldn't have whole communities there who feel really fucking angry and waiting for the kickoff. And it's not just in little green groups. There have been autonomous things throughout history. You know, I mean, you know, this is Zapatistas, and it goes right back to Spain 36. And what usually happens is the people with the vested power circle around, gather together, pull their guns, and then kill everyone. So the history of all anarchist struggles ends with, and then they all got shot. Next chapter. But and so yeah, our main thing is, you know, removing the obstacles, and then you can start to see what's on the other side of it.
Merrick, you said that the IPCC, the Independent Police Complaints Commission, is now stuffed full of police officers and therefore always just sort of okays them. I remember getting arrested and making complaint just before that was set up, and I was interviewed on the radio and sort of, you know, is this going to improve things? And I said, well, we'll have to wait and see how it works. From what you're saying, it isn't working. Can the IPCC be improved to make it really independent, or do we have to scrap it and start again with some other body?
The problem is with scrapping it and starting again is you've got exactly the same problems. And in fact, the new head of the IPCC, whose name I can't remember, Anne, somebody, she is actually starting to get rid of the police officers. So I have a slightly different view from, and I do work with them and I do meet with them occasionally, and I'm very careful about what I tell them and the information I get back. I mean, it has to exist in some form, and it has been given more money because it was quite cash starved, which meant it could only look at a tiny proportion. But it does still have far too many police officers in it. You can't expect police officers to properly examine other police officers. So there are too many. But I think it is slowly changing under, is it Anne Owers? And I personally think she's quite good. She's quite tough. She wrote me a letter the other day that was absolutely appalling. It was so bland. So I wrote a really rude letter back. And I'm hoping perhaps a little bit of fire will escape.
The guy there was talking about control, and I was quite interested in what you were saying about the way they've changed the definition of domestic extremist. Well, a little bit interested. I mean, it seems to me that the police have got a very, very good intuitive sense of what a threat is. And really, what they perceive as a threat, seems to me, is when people are effectively, without really concerning themselves with whether it's lawful or not, doing anything that effectively looks like it may change something. That seems to me the police have a very good sense that people will do something, it'll be effective, more people will do it because it's effective, and you'll get a positive sort of virtuous circle of progressive social change. And when they sense crowds on the street are acting effectively together, they sense straight away, we have to crush this now by whatever means necessary. And I remember at the time of the King's North climate camp, just absolutely not being able to believe that basically a bunch of hippies sitting in a field talking to each other and then, you know, sort of walking around a bit was perceived by the state as such a massive threat that it really warranted being treated like a, you know, sort of like a sort of a border zone in an occupied land. But it seems to me that you know, the police were quite rightly recognizing that if this thing got out of control and people were able to stop any, you know, electricity generation on a scale like that, even for short periods of time, and could carry on growing as a movement, that things might be difficult. So I was wondering, in that definition of domestic extremist, what really seems to be missing, so even in the new one, serious criminality, and like you say, what the hell is serious criminality? Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, I think the thing that we're worth campaigning for is some kind of restriction, and again, people will be, but some kind of narrowing that points to some, you know, element of life and limb, serious risk of physical harm to individuals, something which makes it clear that what we're talking about is violence against individuals. And that would seem to be something worth campaigning about. I don't know how that that change in the definition came about and what lobbying was done to get that far, but it seems to me, as long as you let the police define what criminality is, the whole thing is completely hopeless.
Again, but I think you've got to, coming back to what people said earlier, you've got to be careful about making some people be on the pale and this is okay. This kind of infiltration is not acceptable for anyone. And frankly, if you think that street violence is beyond the pale and is unacceptable, then you should go back and pay your poll tax.
One thing I have noticed is that in the past 4 or 5 years, I talked to a lot of people on doorsteps and that sort of thing, and I don't want to categorise them too much, but I've noticed that a lot of people that I would think of as middle class, very respectable homeowners, probably Lib Dem voters sort of thing, don't trust the police anymore. And I think that's part that has come out of the protest and how they've seen police treat protesters, that they don't like it. So there's now, instead of just being a few people who don't trust the police, I don't know, 10% of us or whatever, we do get now more and more people who don't trust the police. And I think that's very serious for the police. And they have to start thinking very clearly about how they can reconnect with people. One of the things I argue about is that if we're going to have a police force, it really ought to represent the people that it polices. And so in London, it should be 50% female. It should be 25-30% ethnic minority. It should represent the people that it goes out and pushes around or tells how to behave. And we are such a long way off that. So we are bound to have a police force that we don't like very much because they don't look like us. We need more police with beards and grey hair.
This is one of the points where we're going to differ. I think it's intrinsic in the role, what they do. I think it's the power that's vested in them. I think it's the culture that they're in, and they'll take on that. And if you give them more black and ethnic minority people, they will have to fit in with that culture, or they will leave. And if I'm being psychologically and sexually abused by an undercover police officer, or I'm being battened over the head by an undercover police officer, it doesn't matter what gender or what colour of skin on the hand that's wielding the baton.
Can I just...
we've just got time for one more question.
Yeah,
just getting back to the control issue, we've just been on Barton Moss for the winter, and we were a victim of Greater Manchester Police's tactical aid unit, who used to wait 200 yards up the lane until they were off the A57, out of the public eye, and then they would send those people in, and all manner of violence ensued from them. To my knowledge, throughout the whole winter, not one of us retaliated to that violence. And that violence was perpetrated not against sort of middle-aged, whatever you want to call me, younger people. It was perpetrated against the elderly, the infirm, the young. No matter what we did, I've got no faith in the IPCC at all. No matter what we did, we live-streamed everything. And it was all released, and some of it went viral. We had an incident, Teagate, you might have heard about, that had over 4 million hits. We thought it would calm them down a little bit, but no, actually it made them worse. We asked for an audience with Tony Lloyd on several occasions, who's the Greater Manchester Police Commissioner, flatly refused. Peter Farhay went on to do a 20-minute interview, which included nothing but a pack of lies. We had the Flaregate incident, where it was said that we'd let off a flare from camp at a police helicopter. Never happened. That was an excuse for them to come and raid our tents and throw everything out in the wet. It just seemed like we were on a loser throughout. Now, somebody raised something with me the other week, and that they think there's a possibility that the current government is setting the police up to become so unpopular to force privatisation of the police force through the window, through the back door, which I think may be entirely possible. Thoughts on that, please?
Just coming out of the fracking thing, I mean, the fracking campaign is like, I've been doing environmental and social justice campaign for 20 years, I've never seen anything that looks more like a winning campaign. You know, it's got locals, it's got NGOs, institutions, but it's got the direct action on the ground And this is what the Rhodes Movement looked like, but it was much more disorganised. This is a winning campaign, and that's what frightens them. So it doesn't matter how much you show them up, you're politically unacceptable because you're more of a threat. Because you're more of a threat. Yeah. So that's why they're coming for that.
Yeah, yeah. We're so thinly spread on the ground now. I mean, we've got probably about 40 or 50 of us at most full-time that could commit. Now we're seeing sites now being opened one end of the country, the other end of the country, and but we're getting ram ragged right now.
Yeah,
we need more
people
on the ground.
They know that the people on the ground are the tip of the wedge. That it's got the local support, and then it's got the national support and the established environmental support and all of that, and you're the tip of the wedge pushing in. And so it's still a very, very powerful campaign, which is why the police are coming in so hard against it, which is why we've got to keep going.
And of course, what happened at Balcombe was that when it all came to court, including with the Green MP Caroline Lucas, it was thrown out. So again, a huge amount of public money used on, I would say, the wrong purpose. So we can win in the courts as well.
I'm going to stop it there, I'm afraid. Sorry, it's been a really, really interesting. Was there something else you wanted to say, Matt?
Yeah, I just want to say that there are campaigns going on about this. There's eight of the women who are bringing legal action, eight of the women who are abused by undercover officers. They have a group called Police Spies Out of Lives, and it's policespiesoutoflives.org.uk. They're also on Facebook and Twitter, so follow that for that legal case. There are a number of other groups, like the Monitoring Group, who tend to focus on black and minority ethnic repression. And we also got Campaign Opposing Police Surveillance, which is kind of just trying to coordinate all of these and kind of promote and amplify all the various campaigns and different people who've been affected by it. And that's campaignopposingpolicesurveillance.com. On Twitter, it's @copscampaign, and facebook.com, campaignopposingpolicesurveillance.
Great. Thanks very much, Jenny Jones and Merrick.